Let's prepare on disinfection of water. As the continuation of the water treatment, today we are going to see the disinfection process. The main and the basic need for this disinfection is to kill the bacteria present in the water to make it safe for drinking and other purposes. So there are various methods of disinfection. So these are some minor methods. So first one is boiling of water. So if you just boil the water, the bacteria will be killed, but it cannot be used in a large scale. And the next is excess lime. So when the excess lime is added to the water, that is of nearly 14 to 43 ppm means nearly 99.3 to 100% removal of bacteria is possible. But the main problem here is the pH will be increased when the lime is added here. See, even if at pH 9.5, the removal will be 99.9%. So therefore, if we are using excess lime means, then the recarbonation should be done so as to reduce the pH and make it to nearly 7 before providing to the distribution system. And the third one is ozone. So when the ozone gas is introduced into the water, it also acts as a disinfectant. So it will be of lightly blue in color and it is a pungent smelling gas. It is a great oxidizing agent. And if we use nearly 2 to 3 ppm means, it will be having a residual of nearly 0.1 ppm. So when this residue remains in the water, it will be a preventive measure for the water to make it disinfectant even in the distribution system also. 0.1 ppm ozone is nearly equal to the effect of the same 0.15 ppm chlorine. So the intensity of the yellow color that is visible in the orthotoluidine test will be same for these both. The next is the iodine and bromine. So iodine and bromine is added with nearly equal to 8 ppm with a contact time of 5 minutes, and it also cannot be used in a larger scale. It can be minimized for the usage of swimming pools and like small scale treatment plants. And the next is UV rays. So it is only used for water having turbidity less than 15 mg per liter. So we cannot use it for the high turbidity waters, and the small quantity could be only treated with this because the electric support has to be needed and the water has to be passed through that UV rays, and the centimeter of the water that has to be passed also is limited to nearly 10 centimeter or something. So this method can be used for the surgical purposes in hospitals. Potassium permanganate is the normal method which is used in the village site for the treating their well waters. So with the well waters is directly mixed with this potassium permanganate. So when it is mixed, it gives some pink in color. If it is not visible means, it means that it contains more organic matter and pollutant, so that we have to add further also. So nearly 0.05 to 0.1 milligram per liter of residue will be there. It also removes the taste which is caused by the organic matters present in the water. And 1 to 2 milligram per liter of dosage has to be given, and it has to be given a contact time of 4 to 6 hours. The next is silver. Silver is created by the electrocatodyne process. So with the help of the electricity, if we produce this silver ions, means it will be treated with the water. So nearly 0.05 to 0.1 milligram per liter of dosage is given for the contact time of 15 minutes to 3 hours. And the next is chlorination. So this is the common and basic method that is adopted all over our world. So this chlorine, when reacted with water, it gives HOCl, that is the hypochlorous acid. So this happens when the pH is above 5. So this hypochlorous acid further dissociates into the H+ and hypochlorite ion. So these hypochlorous acid and hypochlorite ion, these both are only called as the free chlorine. So these both are very important for the disinfecting process. So the HOCl is more effective, nearly 80% more effective than the hypochlorite ion. So that if we sustain this hypochlorous acid in the water, it means that the disinfectant process will be more effective. So that if we maintain the range between pH of 5 to 7, it means that the dissociation of HOCl can be controlled to a greater extent, so that the disinfection process can be done completely. So further, this chlorine also reacts with the ammonia present in the water and gives various products. So like monochloramine, dichloramine, nitrogen trichloramine, like this various chloramines are formed. So these chloramines are called as combined chlorine. So monochloramine is formed when the pH is greater than 7.5, and dichloramine when the pH is 5 to 6.5 and nitrogen trichloramine at pH less than 4.4. So in this, normally the water will be maintained in the range of 7, nearer to 7. So that the dichloramine has a greater possibility of occurring in the water than the residual chlorine. So the residual chlorine has to be maintained in the water because it has to take care of the further contamination while passing through the distribution system. So nearly 0.2 milligram per liter after 10 minute contact time of the chlorination has to be maintained in the water. And to remove some specific viruses, the free chlorine required should be, that is like poliomyelitis virus, it should be 0.1 milligram per liter, and for the hepatitis virus it is 0.4 milligram per liter. And the various forms of chlorine can be added in these forms, that is the first one is Cl2 gas or liquid also. So the gas will be nearly 2.5 times heavier than the air, and liquid will be 1.5 times heavier than the water. And the next is hypochlorite. So hypochlorite is a chemical form and it is a high test hypochlorite, or perchlorant, it is also named like that. So it is having nearly 60 to 70% of the available chlorine. And the next is bleaching powder. So bleaching powder consists of nearly 30% of the available chlorine. And another one is Cl2 tablets. So it is also used widely now. If we add nearly 0.5 gram of tablet means itself, it will be enough for treating nearly 20 liters of water. And the next is chloramine. So you can directly add chloramine to the water for the better treatment. And the next is chlorine dioxide gas. So this is produced by treating the chlorine with the sodium chloride. So this is nearly 2.5 times stronger than the chlorine. So they go for this method also. The next is the type of chlorination. So the first one is plain chlorination. So this is adopted normally and the dosage is 0.5 milligram per liter or more. The next is pre-chlorination. So this chlorination always we do it after the filtration process only. But if we do this before the filtration or before the sedimentation process, we tell it as pre-chlorination. So this is used, the turbidity of the water is more. So the range of dosage is 5 to 10 milligram per liter, with the residual chlorine has to be 0.1 to 0.5 milligram per liter. The post-chlorination is nothing but that is the residue that has to be maintained in the water. So it is 0.2 milligram per liter. And then the double chlorination. So it is, if we apply both pre-chlorination and post-chlorination, when the turbidity of water is more and it is a highly contaminated water means, we call it as the double chlorination. The next is the breakpoint chlorination. So here, when we add the chlorine to the water, it start consuming and start killing the bacteria. So when it is killing the bacteria, the residual chlorine will be increasing, that is from A to B, you can see in this diagram. So it will be in an increasing stage. So after killing all the bacteria, the organic matter present in the water will be oxidizing. So when this happens, the residual chlorine falls down. So that is from B to C. And after this point C, whatever chlorine if you are adding, it will be remaining as a residual chlorine only. So this is the point called as the break point. So at break point or after the break point, if we add what amount of chlorine also, it will be equal towards the residual chlorine. And the graph goes like this. And the next is superchlorination. So it is 5 to 10 milligram per liter of high dosage. So it is used when some epidemic diseases are broken out in area or in a very contaminated water sites, it can be adopted. And the next is dechlorination. So if the residual chlorination becomes more in a water, then we should dechlorinate it and only send it to the distribution system. So it can be achieved by adding various chemicals or various forms. So one is sulfur dioxide gas and then activated carbon and then sodium thiosulfate, sodium sulfate, sodium bisulfate and ammonia as the form of NH4OH also can be used for the dechlorination. And there are various tests for finding the intensity of the chlorine that is present in the water. So the commonly used test is orthotoledin test. So here the orthotoledin reagent is added to the water and we have to wait for 5 seconds. So after 5 seconds there will be a yellow color blooming there. So this gives the free chlorine intensity alone. So this is compared with the standard solution. Standard colors also will be there. So when we are comparing with that, you can find the amount of residual chlorine or amount of free chlorine present there. After 5 minutes, the intensity of the color will be increasing, and this gives you combined chlorine and free chlorine. So if you take the reading at 5 seconds alone, you can get the free chlorine, and if you take after 5 minutes, you can get the combined chlorine. If you add sodium arsenate to this solution, means the dechlorination will be happening, and so that this free chlorination and combined chlorination won't react to give the color. So after adding this sodium arsenate, if you add the orthotoluidine reagent, means then the color will be coming. So this color is purely due to the presence of the nitrate, iron and manganese. So you can use these values and find the free chlorine, combined chlorine and the total chlorine also. And the next is the DPD test. So it is the reagent added to the water, and similarly to the previous method, here also there will be a red color blooming, so which is compared with the standard solution, so that you can get the amount of chlorine that is present in the water. And the next is the chlorotex. So chlorotex is also a reagent that is used with the water. So here nearly 5 ml of chlorotex is added to 50 ml of water, and a various color range will be obtained from here. So based on various color range, you can directly find the amount of chlorine present in there. So it may be red, purple, violet, blue, pink and red, some various colors are there, and that particular values are also present there. This is the table showing the respective colors and their respective chlorine concentrations. The next is starch iodide test, which we use normally in our laboratory. So 10 ml of potassium iodide to 1 liter of water is added, and then the 5 ml of starch is added so that a blue color will be appearing. So when we titrate it against the sodium thiosulfate, you can get the endpoint. So with that reading, you can find the amount of chlorination present there. And this is a small example problem for calculating the chlorine demand and the chlorine residues present in the water. So here the quantity of water that is treated is given, nearly 20,000 meter cube, and the chlorine used per day is given 8 kg, and the residual chlorine of the water is also given as 0.2 milligram per liter. So now we have to find the dosage of the chlorine and also the residual chlorine. To find the dosage of the chlorine is also given, the water is also there. So if you take the chlorine used divided by the amount of water treated, that is 8 kg per day divided by this 20,000 meter cube. So I have converted here to milligrams and liters because the dosage is in milligram per liter. So you'll get an answer of 0.4 milligram per liter. So this is your chlorine dosage that you have adopted. So now we have to find the residual chlorine. So the chlorine dosage is nothing but the demand, that is the chlorine required for the water to be treated, plus the residual chlorine. So this is only the chlorine dosage we will be applying. So the chlorine demand will be the available chlorine, that is the chlorine dosage minus the residual chlorine. So it is 0.4 minus 0.2, and 0.2 milligram per liter is your chlorine demand. Thank you, and keep watching for the next lecture on water softening methods.